gone fishing.
Well, there's a sign upon your door. Gone fishing.
I'm real gone, man.
You ain't working anymore.
Could be.
There's your hole out in the sun, where you left the row half done. You claim that hoeing ain't no fun.
But I can do it.
You ain't got no ambition. Gone fishing.
Good evening. There is an area of the South Queensland coastline which has been in the news because of a petition to prevent mineral sand mining in the area. Considering the location of this desolate strip of coastline, uninhabited but for the personnel of the lighthouse, those not aware of its natural beauty may wonder why there should be such a public outcry. Not many people, even Queenslanders, have been lucky enough to view this place in all its rugged splendour. For the benefit of those who have not had the opportunity to see this Teewah Sands area, we organised an expedition to try to capture some of its beauty on film. Let us first pinpoint the area on a map. Beginning at the northern head of the Noosa River entrance, it extends a distance of some 35 miles to the Double Island Point Lighthouse. Then, beyond the light, a further 16 miles of calm or semi-surf water known as Wade Bay, which has a northern boundary at Inskip Point. Inskip forms the southern entrance to Harvey Bay. But our interest lies in the area south of the lighthouse, for it is here that we find the Teewah Sands. It is perhaps hard to realise that within 130 miles of Brisbane lies an area so inaccessible and devoid of civilization. In planning our route, we had to decide whether we would cross the Noosa River and travel along the hard low-tide sand of the beach, or alternatively drive further north, skirting the upper reaches of the river to take the unmade tracks through the bushland. First, we considered crossing the river, but found that no public transport or ferry was available. There are a few privately owned barges on which it is possible to ferry a car across by working along a wire stretched from bank to bank. To the motorcyclists shown making the crossing, this is the easiest way, but there is an element of risk involved with a heavy vehicle. Once the river has been crossed, the beach is in places up to 100 yards wide at low tide and is hard enough for two-wheel drive vehicles or motorcycles to maintain good speed. For this reason, some ardent fishermen buy old unregistered cars and leave them in the bush on the north bank, ready to be driven up the beach without the worry of transporting them across the river. However, we decided to travel further north and enter the beach through the military road. We had the rover well stocked with provisions, fishing gear and bait, for our photographers are also very keen fishermen. After driving through Pomona, Kinkin and Woolvi, we arrived at the Forestry Road turnoff and prepared for the roughest part of the drive. We bumped and jogged along tracks rarely used by anyone but the forestry and military, and some 90 minutes later we neared the coast. After twisting and turning between trees, at a maximum speed of about 15 miles an hour, we came at last to the steep sandy track down the cliff face. Getting down the track was easy, but we noticed that a vehicle climbing this path had considerable trouble, and timber had to be placed under the wheels for traction. Being hardened saltwater anglers, we do not usually stop to consider the beauty of nature, yet we were immediately struck with the thought, here is a place so different from our populated beaches. So before we succumbed to the temptation of starting to fish, we traveled along the beach to examine these features of the country. Our attention was immediately attracted by the sandstone formations rising amidst the trees like medieval castles. With the passage of time, towers and chimneys have been hewn from the rock by the wind and weather, and at first glance they looked like man-made fortresses. Even when we moved closer, the formations still reminded us of storybook palaces. The surrounding trees provided a sharply contrasting background, emphasizing the illusion. Some of these sand cliffs are up to 600 foot high, and carbon tests prove their age to be not less than 40,000 years. The tourist feature of this area is the sand itself, which is so multicolored in the cliff faces that some of the colors are collected in bottles or test tubes and sold as souvenirs. In all, some 72 colors and shades of sand have been seen in the area. The beauty of these hills at sunrise must be seen to be fully appreciated, as the color is distributed over large areas. Geologists claim that the principal coloring agent in these sands is iron oxide, which imparts the various shades of red, yellow, brown, blue, and gray. Others who have studied the area claim that rainwater, affected by decayed vegetation, colors the sand as it passes through them. Whatever the scientific explanation, the Aboriginals who once lived in this area have a far more picturesque idea of the origin of the colors. They tell the legend of a beautiful Aboriginal maiden who was in love with the rainbow. She was kidnapped by a warrior from a distant tribe, but managed to escape. The warrior pursued her and was about to kill her with his magic boomerang when the faithful rainbow appeared. The rainbow moved in front of the boomerang, and they met with a roar like thunder. The boomerang was smashed, and without its magic, the warrior was powerless. But in saving the maiden's life, the rainbow was shattered into a million pieces, which fell to the beach, giving their color to the sands. The Aborigine women believed so strongly in this pretty piece of fantasy that they made long treks to obtain the sands to wear or carry as good luck charms. Another interesting phenomenon, aptly known as the bubbler, is a freshwater stream bubbling merrily up from the beach sand with no visible source. The surrounding sand is constantly being shifted by the influence of this underground stream, and consequently has not the firmness to carry a vehicle. This is a trap which the unwary driver could easily fall into when working the beach. As can be seen, an 8-foot piece of timber drives easily 4 foot down in this area just with the weight of an arm. Another motoring hazard on the beach is the occasional large tide, which forces vehicles well back to the cliffs. The sand at the base of these cliffs is often treacherously soft. However, there are one or two places where motorists can drive their vehicles into cuttings in the hills and so get above the tide. Just as on the highways, there is always the motorist who takes one risk too many. The tide and sand soon make short work of the car caught in their path or unfortunate enough to break down on the beach below high water mark. But it is hard to keep an angler's mind on natural beauty when there are fish about. Even as we paused to take another look at the Teewah sandhills, one of our party donned his fishing waders to give us the hint to get underway. So we drove towards the lighthouse at Double Island Point. To avoid confusion, we must make it clear that Double Island is in fact not in any way an island. It is part of the main coastline, but cuttings in the cliffs seen from far out at sea gave early mariners the impression that the point was separated from the mainland. It is a headland of rock and sandy soil over 250 foot high, surrounded by sheer cliff faces. On the highest point is the lighthouse, standing 315 foot above sea level. The light is visible for 25 miles and is one of the major aids to shipping along this section of the Queensland coast. It is also a very important weather station, and being a government reserve, the area should not be entered without the lighthouse keeper's permission. This is a glorious viewpoint, and we scanned the panorama, looking across Wide Bay towards Inskip Point. Much of this beach is bounded by inaccessible sand cliffs, similar to those in the Teewah Sands area. The bay cuts well in, is protected in most weather, and usually semi-surf or still conditions prevail. But by now, the keen fishermen were no longer interested in the scenery. They were looking longingly at the rocky point in front of the lighthouse. "Let's just go down and have a look," they said. "There must be fish there." For some odd reason, they took down their rods, reels, and bait, just to help them look. Far from being impressed with the rugged scenery, their first thought was to scan the place for a likely rock from which they could fish in safety. Once they had seen evidence of movement of tailor, mackerel, and tuna, all else was forgotten. With a cry, "There's fish out there, thick," they started scrambling over rocks. Yet there was really no hurry, for the added attraction of this area is that given reasonable weather, it is a fisherman's mecca. The rocky formations at the lighthouse spread in a semicircle, and even in the rougher weather, it is usually possible to find a lee side fishing spot somewhere on the point. These deep waters right up to the rocks produce snapper and big brim when bottom fishing, as well as the top feeding tailor and mackerel. One of the anglers on the rocks soon had his rod well bent with the weight of a really good fish. This fish was a 35 pound tuna, and landing it on a 15-pound line was a test of skill for the angler, who was using the long 14-foot rod and 6.5-inch Alvey sidecast reel. The tuna, the largest on this outing, was the forerunner of many more to be taken as unweighted baits of whole garfish were cast into the water from the rocks. We were keen to try the beach areas, and we tried to convince our friends that the rocks were not the only potential fishing spot. The fish were still biting well, but we managed with some difficulty to drag them away. We then changed to our lighter rods and lines and went prospecting in the Stillwater lagoons north of the light. In the shelter of the headlands, half a mile of calm water forms these lagoons, which are bounded by sandbanks through which blue water channels wind their way out to Wide Bay. Here we found large numbers of brim, flathead, and whiting. The spots we tried all held fish, and we formed the conclusion that if it's light gear fishing you want, or if the beach and headlands prove to be unfishable because of weather, fish are in this calm water for the taking. We talked to a few lucky people who come to this area regularly, and they assured us that these fish are available all year round. The class of fish was well worthwhile, flathead 4 and 5 pounds weight being common, the brim often up to and over 2 pounds. In this clear water we could often see the flathead we were trying to catch, yet it did not stop them from biting. Bait is not a problem, as beach worms and eugrie, that is pippies, are in abundance. As our storage space for fish was limited, and it was our intention to fish the dawn hours on the beach, we stopped fishing long before dusk, even though the fish seemed willing to keep biting. A sleeping tent was erected, and our conscripted cook showed some of his culinary talent by preparing the evening meal. Resisting the desire to go and catch more fish, we sat around the campfire, relating previous battles with fish, until one by one the party retired for the night. Just on daybreak we were up, broke camp and set off. We studied the beach from the lighthouse headland and picked ourselves a few likely looking gutters well along the beach and set off toward them, travelling along the hard beach sand. Long before we reached these spots, we came to a small narrow gutter receiving a lot of interest from seagulls. We knew that something was on, and taking our long 13-foot-6 beach rods and Alvey sidecast reels, we baited our four-hook chain rig with seagar. Using only a 12-pound breaking strain line, we were easily able to cast the 50 yards necessary without the addition of lead weight. At the first splash of a bait, interest was taken by a tailer weighing about 3 pounds. Others in the party cast in and barely had time to turn their reels back to winding position before the fish grabbed the bait as it hit the water. This place certainly is an angler's dream when the weather is right. Soon fish littered the beach, as it is our practice to let a tailer lie on the beach with broken gill connection for a short time to allow the fish to bleed and the flesh to firm. Those adverse to cleaning fish began to worry as the tally mounted. We wondered if we had just picked a lucky spot, so to investigate properly we left this hole to find out if fish were also in other spots. The shoreline is a maze of gutters, holes and drains which would delight any angler, so it did not take long to find another spot. Only at the very top of the tide is it hard to find good water close to the shore. Indeed, by looking through the clearness of the last wave, we could often see fish right in near the shoreline. Because of the remoteness and lack of civilization, fish in this area seem to have no fear of working in very close to the beach, nor do the movements of anglers on the beach frighten them away. Their fight starts in close while they work parallel to the beach along the crest of the waves. Often when we were bringing in a fish, other tailor would follow the hook fish and snap at the flash of the bright brass swivel. To prevent this, many anglers blacken swivels before use, and a darkened swivel is expected to be available on the market soon. As the fish near the beach, they start jumping and tail walking like game fish, trying to dislodge the hooks or bluff the angler into giving slack line to allow them to escape, for tailor are adept at throwing hooks if the angler is careless. Soon our carrying capacity was taxed to its limit, and we set to the task of filleting the fish. We did not spend time scaling or gutting the fish, as with practice it is an easy matter to take the two sides away with a boning knife. The fillets pack down well, and not until just before cooking do we consider the scales. Then we skin the fillet, taking away the skin and scales in one action. With all our gear packed, we were reluctant to leave this fisherman's paradise where rock fishing, beach fishing, and light gear angling are equally rewarding. To add to these many angling virtues, there are several places along the beach where small submerged reefs are within easy casting distance. These produce good reef fish in some seasons. On our return trip, we decided to travel right along the miles of beach sand toward the Noosa Bar and make the river crossing. As we neared the Noosa River, we had to leave the beach and make our way through the long grass of the swampy flats to the barge landing. While it is only a few miles, this track is very rough in parts. When we arrived at the barge, we drove our vehicle on board and prepared to make the crossing. Fortunately, the river was calm, as there was only a light breeze blowing, and we reached the landing on the southern bank without incident. The time saved on the return trip allowed us to take one last look right up the beach. Indeed, this is a coastline of unusual beauty. The sands, the stream, the rugged hills all make it a place worth seeing. Given good weather, the fabulous fishing makes it doubly worthwhile to visit Double Island Point. Now that our trip is over, we hope you have enjoyed coming with us to the famous Teewah Sands. Perhaps one day you will have an opportunity to make the trip in person. My advice is, don't miss it. Thanks for your interest.
Folks won't find us now because Mr. Satch and Mr. Cross, we gone fishing instead of just a wishing. Oh, yeah.